Hi, Mystery Recapped here. Today, I'm going to explain the British science fiction romance thriller called Frequencies. Spoilers ahead, watch out, and take care. The movie is set in a dystopian world where every person emits a specific frequency which determines his or her luck, further determining his or her success in life. Higher frequency means better luck, and thus, less feelings. The movie starts as we see some students standing in a single line, each holding a single green apple. Marie Curie Fortune, a bright young girl, is one of the students in the line. The student behind her drops his apple, and she very calmly returns it back to him. The scene then cuts to the students sitting at their desks, preparing for an exam, as their teacher gives them instructions and tells them to begin. Just then, all the students put on their respective blindfolds and begin working on the test. After the test is over, the teacher announces their names individually and hands them their results. Outside, the students discuss the result among themselves. Marie Curie proudly boasts her score of 127, while her friends receive scores far lower than hers. One of Marie's arrogant friends then introduces her to Isaac Newton Mitchell, who introduces himself to Marie as Zach. Marie is told that Zach has a frequency of -7. The arrogant friend wanted them to meet as they have exact opposite frequencies, extreme high and extreme low. As they stare at each other, it starts raining abruptly. The teacher then calls Zach as his mother has come to meet him. It turns out that high frequency people and low frequency people repel each other. From the moment Zach met Marie to the time the teacher calls Zach back was exactly 1 minute, which means they can only be in contact for no longer than a minute. Marie's parents are concerned that their daughter will never be like other children because of her complete lack of empathy. They visit one of her teachers to discuss their queries. The teacher clears that because of her extremely high frequency and high luck, she has less feelings. When asked if they can live a normal life like others, the teacher says that it won't be possible at all. Fast forward into the future, and we see an older teenage Marie presenting her science project to the same teacher, Miss Anderson. It is a device that can analyze frequencies of two opposite sex people and tell if they are compatible or not. The therapist praises her ingenuity and says that it might also help people make friends and that she herself should try to use it. This prompts Marie to then perform several experiments to find out whether two people with very different frequencies can ever have a meaningful connection, or if there is a way for someone to increase their frequency. She chooses a test subject that has a frequency on the lower end of the spectrum, Zach. In the first experiment, she interrogates Zach, who is very awkward with the answers. As the clock ticks 60 seconds, an airplane starts dropping luggage onto Zach, which he narrowly evades, thus proving the theory that two people from extremely opposite frequencies cannot stay together for more than a minute. Miss Anderson comes onto the scene and warns Marie that frequencies cannot be changed. In the subsequent experiments, she meets Zach for exactly 1 minute and catalogs everything that he says to her. It is clear from his behavior that Zach is interested in Marie, but can never seem to get across to her. Also, in each of the experiments, the duo gets separated before the 1 minute threshold. Finally, Zach confesses that he loves her and asks her if she feels the same. She responds by saying that she is incapable of feeling anything because of her condition. She continues that she shows emotions only to pretend in front of others. Huh, just like Jeff Bezos. However, her goal is to one day feel emotions. The movie then again fast forwards in time, this time to when Marie is an adult. It shows how her daily life plays out with her performing everyday tasks in the same emotionless state. When she is resting at home, her friends and family come over to give her a surprise birthday party. She sits alone during the party until she is approached by Zach. They talk briefly until Zach reminds her that the clock has crossed 60 seconds. He then says that he has found a way to help her, and thus she agrees to meet with him. Later, the duo meet at a place. Zach reveals that he lasted more than a minute the last time because he increased his frequency. He then tells Marie that there is a way for her to be able to connect with other people by lowering her energy levels. He explains that it will require physical contact. Oh, sneaky, sneaky, Zach. She is skeptical at first, but since she is eager to experience some form of emotion, she lays her hand on the table, and then Zach grasps it in his. Marie is completely overwhelmed. She feels something but cannot describe it, because she doesn't know what it feels like to experience emotion. She feels unwell and lets go of his hand, but realizes that holding hands had actually made her feel better. Since they have been talking for way more than the designated 60 seconds, nature begins to rebel, and Marie, feeling overwhelmed, kisses Zach. We then experience the story from Zach's perspective. The boy at the beginning who dropped the apple was Zach himself, and he liked Marie from the start. When the teacher calls in Zach from the playground to meet his mother, it was so that they could discuss his future in the institute with Miss Anderson. She recommends that Zach be shifted to a different facility because his frequency is too low and that he will never fit in with the others. Zach adamantly refuses. After the ordeal, Zach makes his way to Theo's house, his only friend. When he gets to the house, he is met by Theo's father, who shows him that he has skills different from everyone else's because of his ability to use his imagination. This is manifested when he finds out that he is excellent with the piano because of his ability to see the piano progressions. This is more math than imagination, but we'll let this one slide. With Theo, he learns that he cannot be with Marie because a high energy person and a low energy person create magnetic fields that repel each other and cause destruction. The movie then fast forwards to Zach's teenage years, where he, like Marie, is presenting a project at the science fair. Marie comes to his station and asks to meet him after school. Both of them clearly have different agendas. Marie wants to experiment on Zach, while Zach just wants to slide into her DMs, and, determined to improve his frequency, tries his best to establish contact with Marie. We see that to increase his own frequency, Zach, with the help of Theo, uses magnets to temporarily boost his frequency. Zach experimented with different substances before each meeting with Marie to see which would have the most desirable effect. However, they didn't help much, as Marie admitted to feeling nothing towards Zach. Fast forward again to when Zach is an adult. He presents a groundbreaking theory that redefines the concept of frequencies. He tells the professors that every high-frequency person can experience emotion if they believe in it. Unfortunately for him, no one buys his idea. This is how I imagine global summits about the climate crisis play out. Zach again meets with Theo to find ways to improve his frequency. They experiment with different compounds, but unexpectedly realize that particular sound waves can boost frequency for a short period of time. To test this hypothesis, he is sent by Theo to meet Marie at her birthday party. While departing, Theo gives him a device with code words to activate the sound waves, thus giving him an additional 5 seconds more this time. During their conversation, he's also wearing a microphone through which he can hear Theo giving him new words. Everything comes full circle when both of them kiss. The intimacy has the effect of reducing Marie's frequency and quelling the revolt of nature. The couple then make love for the first time. All this while, Zach keeps getting the secret words on his device, which extends his time with Marie. I'd sure like to know what those words were. They begin to spend more time together. During their time together, Marie experiences some bouts of unluckiness, such as missing her train. This is a clear sign that her frequency is dwindling. She then makes a bold move and takes Zach to visit her parents. Her parents, in many ways, are high-frequency individuals like her, so they are concerned that when an average boy comes into their house, the frequency mismatch would cause a rebellion of nature. Marie ensures them that it will not happen, and then the entire family has dinner together. At the table, Zach explains to Marie's father how the concept of harmonizing frequencies works. He explains that nature will always seek balance so that high-frequency and low-frequency people can be together because the low-frequency individual will receive some of the energy of the high-frequency individual. This is how Kanye and Kim Kardashian worked. This will cause uniformity and everyone can be the same level. He then presents his device to Marie's father and explains how it works. It basically takes the frequency mismatch between the people in the surroundings and presents a two-syllable word that can help balance out the frequency. Marie's father is very excited to hear that a device can be used to achieve complete balance. He believes that the device would render the concept of high energy and low energy to be useless, thus giving everyone justice. In fact, Marie's father is so confident in the idea of universal balance that he puts together a research team to improve the device's functionality. The team consists of some of Zach's old schoolmates. However, they soon discover a strange side effect. If one asks anyone to do anything after saying the two-syllable word, they will do it involuntarily. While Zach and Marie's father try to figure out how to fix the glitch, Marie comes to a realization that when Zach met her at her birthday party, he was using carefully selected words to lower her frequency. Then, with the two-syllable word and a meek request, he subconsciously compelled her to fall in love with him. Marie's father is furious at Zach for manipulating his daughter like that. To his defense, Zach says that he had no knowledge of the side effect and that the entire thing was a misunderstanding. Ironically, this is also what Bill Cosby said. Needless to say, Marie's father disbands the team and makes everyone sign a contract to drop the idea of experimenting with the device. He also forbids Zach from seeing Marie again. One day, upon returning to his room, Zach finds some men in his room. One of the men says that they are from the government. He even has the same device that Zach invented. The man then asks Zach 3 questions, and he can only respond by nodding his head. Zach realizes that the questions the man was asking were phrased in such a way that they would ensure he was telling the truth. Zach doesn't understand how that is possible, because no one else was privy to the work they had been doing with his device. The man then offers Zach a job. After Zach reaches the secret place, the man explains that the government has set up a secret team. He stresses that the team needs to neutralize the threat, known as the Manual, which is the name given to the 2-syllable generator device. The team consists of the team that Marie's father set up before, since only they knew how it worked. The government agent then tells them the story of how his technology had surfaced several times in the past and caused devastation, but had always been obscured from the public to keep the balance and peace. He knew that it would inevitably be rediscovered and that again, they would have to bury it in secrecy. Over the next few days, the team works very diligently, trying to figure out how to overcome this problem. They all put forth their ideas, suggestions, and mathematical models to resolve it, but never make it to a consensus. Meanwhile, Marie's father is still cold towards Zach. Zach then suggests making an anti-manual, one that is flawed, so that its perception in the public is tainted, and people are less likely to be inclined to use it. Also, he realizes that from his study of patterns, there must be some antidote words to nullify the effect of the glitching words. All of them stick to this theory to try it out. They end up producing words that implicate harmless commands, but can only be used once every hour. The government official isn't pleased to replace one havoc-causing word with another, and so he bans the words immediately. Later, at the request of Marie, Zach utters a word from the device, along with a command, so that Marie will fall out of love with him. However, she says that nothing has changed. When the government agent comes to know that Zach tried manipulation again, he is locked into confinement and is forbidden to speak with anyone. In the state of solitary, however, Zach's mind begins to wander the depth of his knowledge and procure everything he knows on the subject to find a solution, an antidote. Thoughts and cacophonous sounds whiz through his mind until the solution becomes clear to him. He knows where to find the antidote. Desperate to find it, Zach lures the guard into his room and utters a single word that freezes him in place. Zach has become a goddamn Jedi. He then escapes the secret facility. He makes his way to Theo's father's home, where he knows he will find the antidote. Theo's dad realizes that Zach has figured it out and offers to help him. Marie also arrives at the scene and informs him that he has less time. Just then, the government officials storm the place and restrain Zach. Suddenly, Theo's dad begins playing a melody on his piano. When asked what he is doing, he replies that he is simply giving them the antidote. He then challenges them to use any word while he is playing. The government official does so, and to their surprise, it makes no difference. This is exactly how Wonderwall works. Theo's dad then reveals that when Mozart plays, everyone is in the same frequency. He continues by saying that music neutralizes the power of words, and that Mozart immunized people against the book that contained the words. In short, music resets everything, especially Island Boy by the Pineapple Brothers. The final segment is shown from Theo's perspective. It is revealed that he was the one who dropped the apple so that Zach would talk to Marie. It is also revealed that Theo has exactly average frequency. What follows is an interesting dynamic between Theo and his dad. His dad believes that humans can escape the entrapment of machine-like thinking by using imagination and their concept of free will. Theo, on the other hand, believes that all humans are machines, and they can be very predictable. All of Theo's work during the course of the movie has reflected this very mindset, from his helping Zach control frequencies to his science project that was obstructed by the Zach-Marie attraction. Elsewhere, Marie and Zach are together and get their results back from the doctor, who gives them doses of Mozart, Bach, and Pach Bell as medicines. What, no Nickelback? The doctor also confirms that Marie's feelings are not due to manipulation. The movie ends on a high note when Theo believes he has figured out the Universal Symphony, a complete knowledge of things that will allow him to predict how any interaction or event is going to happen. So, that leaves the question, did anyone in the movie ever have free will? Or were they just the product of their frequencies? This is getting too deep for me. I'm out. Subscribe for more videos like this, turn on notifications, and leave a like to help the channel out. Thank you for watching.